So welcome you all in the second session of the International Virtual Conference of Drug Discovery and Delivery. So in our first speaker in this session is Dr. Santosh Rudravar. So I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Santosh Rudravar. He is presently the group leader, Menzies Health Institute, Queensland, Griffith University, Australia, and program director, Bachelor of Pharmacology and Toxicology at Griffith University. Before joining Griffith, he was ARCD CRA fellow and lecturer, the University of Sydney from 2014 to 2015. He did his master's in 2001 and joined discovery research at Dr. Reddy's laboratories for 2 years. After that, he did PhD from Naipaul, Mohali, followed by postdoctoral fellowship from 2008 to 2013. He has more than 45 publications to his credit. With this, I invite Dr. Santosh for his talk on part one, sugar kick prevents memory impairment, and part second, multi-target profiling strategies for neurodegenerative disease. Over to you, Dr. Santosh.
Thank you very much. And thank you, Hemant, for giving me opportunity to present my work today. So in this presentation, I will talk about we are doing in our lab at Griffith University. Due to the advancement in medicine and technology, we are living longer. And as the life expectancy increases, the chances of getting neurodegenerative diseases such as Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease also increases. Currently, there is no cure for these diseases due to several reasons. And one of the reasons is poor understanding of the development of these diseases, how these diseases are developed. And another reason is current approaches, they focus on one drug, one target, whereas these neurodegenerative diseases, Alzheimer's and Parkinson, these are like multifactorial diseases. So for in case of Alzheimer's disease, once these amyloid beta peptide aggregates or tau peptide protein aggregates, initiate several events. So at the same time, we need to target other events such as oxidative stress or activation of various inflammatory processes. So due to these reasons, currently there is no drug which is currently available for treatment of Alzheimer's disease or Parkinson's disease. So our lab at Griffith University, we are focusing on understanding of the development of these neurodegenerative diseases so that it will help us to develop some therapeutics. So in today's presentation, I will briefly discuss two approaches on which we are currently working. The first one is sugar kick prevents memory impairment. So before the this Human Genome Project, it was assumed that, or it was expected that humans might have more than 100,000 genes, because a simple organism such as water fly or rice, small, it has close to like 40,000 genes. And humans, we are such a complex organism. Everyone was expecting that we must be having more than 100,000 genes. After the completion of this Human Genome Project, everyone was surprised because we have less than 25,000 genes. So everyone was surprised. How come we are such a complex organism and we got such a less amount number of genes compared to water fly, which is a tiny organism? So is it due to the humans we are surprisingly simple, or something else? So the reason behind this small number of genes is our genome is simple, but our proteome is really very complex. And it is due to this post-translational modification. So once protein is formed in our body, this protein gets modified by a range of enzymes or range of processes, which involves covalent addition of various functional groups such as methylation, sulfation, phosphorylation, or glycosylation. So due to this post-translational modification, what happens? So even we have few genes, which is like less than 25,000 genes, But these genes can form more than 1 million proteins due to this post-translational modification. So our genome is proteome is complex compared to our genome, and that's why even we have such a small number of genes compared to other organisms, still we can make a complex or large number of proteins. The reason is post-translational modification. So this post-translational modification involves phosphorylation and glycosylation. These are the most common post-translational modification, and these modifications, they are responsible for activation of proteins or deactivation of proteins. So they regulate various cellular processes by just modifying these proteins. And one protein can undergoes these post-translational modifications several times through the life cycle of that protein. So in my presentation, we're focusing on glycosylation. That's one of the post-translational modification. So glycosylation, there are different types of glycosylation: N-glycosylation, O-glycosylation, C-glycosylation. But for this talk, we'll focus only on protein O-glycosylation. So addition of this sugar residue, O-glycosylation, on the serine and threonine residue of various proteins. So this O-glycosylation modification is called as O-glycosylation. So addition of this one sugar residue. And this reaction is catalyzed by enzyme O-glycosylation transferase, which is OGT. So far, more than 4,000 proteins have been identified as a substrate for this enzyme, O-glycosylation transferase. And this modification is dynamic. So it means we can also remove this sugar residue by the action of this enzyme, O-glycosylation hydrolase or OGA. And during the life cycle of that protein, it can undergo O-glycosylation modification several times. And one protein can have different modification, like there are several modification on one single protein. And this O-glycosylation modification controls the reactivity, translocation, and function of various structure and function of various proteins. And it involves various oncogenic factors or various proteins which are involved in various cellular processes. So the similar post-translational modification is phosphorylation. In our body, we have only two enzymes which are responsible for this O-glycosylation modification. One is OGT, which adds sugar residue, and OGA, which removes sugar residue. It's like a eraser and pencil. So these are the only two enzymes we have in our body, and there are more than 4,000 substrates which undergoes this modification. So similar post-translational modification is phosphorylation. So phosphorylation site and O-glycosylation modification site, they have comparable in our body. So same set of proteins, they undergo glycosylation as well as phosphorylation. And nature selected just one enzyme to do this modification, O-glycosylation modification. Whereas for phosphorylation, we have more than 500 kinase enzymes, which are responsible for addition of phosphate residues on various proteins. And we have more than 150 phosphatases, which removes phosphate group from the protein. So it's really surprising how come we have more than 500 kinases to add phosphate, and we have only one enzyme, which is OGT, to add this glycosylation residue on various proteins. So that's why we are interested in understanding the role of this O-glycosylation transferase and OGA in various metabolic diseases. So there are more than 4,000 proteins which undergo this glycosylation, which includes various cytoplasmic and nuclear protein, and various oncogenic factors. They are also undergo this glycosylation by O-glycosylation transferase, and that's why O-glycosylation transferase is overexpressed in almost every cancer. So we don't know what is the role of this O-glycosylation OGT in various cancers. So still we are working on development of some inhibitory probes for this enzyme, because currently there is no inhibitor available for this enzyme. So few proteins which are also involved in oligonucleotide, which are also involved in neurodegenerative diseases, such as amyloid precursor protein, tau protein, alpha synuclein, and neurofilament. So these proteins are also substrate for OGT. So in normal brain or healthy brain, so these proteins, they are glycosylated. So all these proteins, they have oligonucleotide sugar on there. So these oligonucleotide is decorated on these protein in healthy brain. So what happens, as I mentioned, this glycosylation and phosphorylation, they share a few modification sites. So if there is no glycosylation, and then phosphorylation takes place, and once we have phosphate group on these proteins, they get aggregated, and that's what they form these aggregates in tau pathies and in Alzheimer's. So it has been reported that this oligonucleotide residue protects these proteins from aggregation. And various neurodegenerative diseases such as Alzheimer's disease involves aggregation of amyloid beta protein or aggregation of tau protein, whereas Parkinson's involves aggregation of alpha synuclein protein. So all these proteins in healthy brain, they get glycosylated. They have these oligonucleotide sugar residues on these proteins. So recently, Merck reported their candidate MK8719. So this is a sugar-based compound, and this compound is a OGA inhibitor. So it has been, as I mentioned, the oligonucleotide residue protects protein from aggregation by stopping or by avoiding phosphorylation. So the idea behind this OGA development is OGA will MK8719. OGA inhibitor is, it inhibits this enzyme OGA so that sugar residues can stay on tau protein, and so that it cannot get phosphorylated, and that's what happens in healthy brain. So if you not inhibit this OGA enzyme, and then it will remove this sugar residue on this this protein, and then it can phosphorylate by various kinase enzyme, and once it forms this phosphorylated tau, then forms oligomer, and then PHF, and then neurofibrillary tangles. So that's how this disease progression takes place in Alzheimer's. So this MK8719, it inhibits this OGA enzyme so that tau protein cannot get aggregated in Alzheimer's diseases. So they are currently undertaking human trials for this MK8719. So this compound MK8719 was developed based on this transition state analog. So oxazolin is a transition state. So the first compound was Pognac. So Professor David O'Kendall from Simon Fraser University, he is involved in development of OGA inhibitor. So he is a pioneer in OGA development, drug development. And the first compound was based on this oxazolin transition state. And though this compound was potent as an OGA inhibitor, but due to the lack of selectivity, this compound cannot be considered for further development. Replacement of this acyclic structure with this thiazolin gave this NAC-thiazolin, which is more potent than Pognac. But again, due to the selectivity, this compound was not further developed. By addition of this additional alkyl group on this thiazolin 2 position, that exploited the cavity present in OGA. So now this this compound becomes selective for OGA. And further addition of this NH group here, so that make this compound more metabolically stable. And by modification or replacement of this hydroxyl group with the difluoro group, and this compounds became blood-brain barrier permeable, so CNS penetration. So in this conversion of thiamide G to MK8719, they focused on replacement of hydroxyl group with the difluoro group, which make it more lipophilic, and it increases the topological polar surface area. So this compound is currently phase 1 clinical trial. So all this drug development of OGA development is based on idea that oblique neck residue protects protein from aggregation in neurodegenerative disease. So we're also interested in developing probes or understanding the aggregation process, but our approach is slightly different. We believe that targeting these upstream processes, glycosylation and deglycosylation by various enzymes might result into mechanism-based toxicity. So our focus is development of some glycopeptides and try to understand how these glycosylation proteins, these proteins involved in various neurodegenerative diseases. So glycosylation and oblique neck modification is involved in various neurodegenerative diseases. It protects these proteins from aggregation. Tau neurofilaments and alpha synuclein, these proteins, they are directly glycosylated by OGT. Whereas amyloid beta and Huntington proteins, they are modification takes place at upstream mediators. So as I mentioned, various proteins, they get glycosylated, and which includes various cytoplasmic and nuclear proteins. So we are interested in three proteins which are involved or implicated in neurodegenerative diseases. The first one is alpha-synuclein, and the second is tau, and third one is amyloid precursor protein. So now talking about the alpha-synuclein, and there are a few oblique neck modification sites they are confirmed. So this alpha-synuclein, it contains three distinct domains. And the first one is N-terminal domain. And the second one is non-amyloid component, the middle one from amino acid 61 to 95. And third one is C-domain. C-terminal domain. So the NAC domain is basically responsible for aggregation of alpha-synuclein in Parkinson's disease. This NAC segment, it contains very lipophilic peptides, amino acids, so they're prone to aggregate. And we were interested in identifying what exactly these sugar residue involved in prevention of this aggregation. So can we use this NAC segment for development of some glycopeptides which will help us to understand how this oblique neck modification might prevent aggregation of alpha-synuclein in Parkinson's disease. So our hypothesis is, as in healthy brain, this alpha-synuclein is modified with oblique neck, and that's what happens in healthy brain, which prevents this alpha-synuclein from aggregation. In case of Parkinson's disease, so this alpha-synuclein loses its oblique neck residue, sugar, and due to the loss of sugar molecule, it aggregates and forms these Lewy bodies. So which are like hallmark of Parkinson's disease. So we thought if we develop a peptide or identify a peptide, glycopeptide, so this peptide can bind to the alpha-synuclein, and this sugar residue, oblique neck, will act as a distractor. So it disturbs this binding, so it cannot aggregate. So these probes can bind to this alpha-synuclein, but due to the sugar residue, it will prevent them for aggregation. So that was our hypothesis. And we're trying to understand how the sugar molecule will help to prevent aggregation of alpha-synuclein in Parkinson's disease. So based on this hypothesis, we selected to synthesize a panel of peptides and glycopeptides. So we selected NAC segment. This is a truncated NAC segment from peptide amino acid from 71 to 82 or 68 to 77. And we introduced sugar glycosylate NAC, which is here, at various position. We also introduced one linker, the glycine. And also we used D and L amino acid. So this is the L amino acid, and we also use D amino acid. And to understand the role of various so basically, this part of the molecule should recognize alpha-synuclein, and this sugar will prevent it from aggregation. So that was the main idea behind developing these glycopeptide-peptide panels. So this synthesis of these glycopeptides we carried out by following solid phase peptide synthesis protocol using ring amide resin. So this glycopeptide we assembled, and we use this GlycNAc modified amino acid serine for this glycopeptide synthesis. So for those who are new to solid phase peptide synthesis, I will just briefly discuss how we carried out this peptide synthesis. This solid phase peptide synthesis, FMOC solid phase peptide synthesis, involves using a linker and solid support. And then first step involves loading of amino acid, which is orthogonally protected. So this is orthogonally protected amino acid. So side chains are protected with acyl labile protecting group, and amino terminal is protected with base labile protecting group. So you load amino acid by coupling reagents, and then you deprotect the N-terminal FMOC group under basic condition, and then you couple second amino acid here by following coupling condition, standard coupling conditions, and then you assemble second amino acid. And you repeat this process, so deprotection of this N-terminal FMOC group under basic condition, and you keep on coupling amino acid till you reach your desired peptide synthesis, and finally you attach that glycosylated amino acid. And final step involves cleavage from the resin, as well as deprotection of this side chain protecting group under acidic condition. So this method was developed by Merrifield, and for which he received a Nobel Prize. So by following this solid phase FMOC peptide synthesis, we developed or we synthesized this panel of glycopeptides for evaluation of their aggregation inhibition for alpha-synuclein. And then to test these compounds, whether they can inhibit aggregation on alpha-synuclein, which is involved in Parkinson's disease. So we carried out this thioflavin T assay, fluorescence assay. So this assay is generally used as a first step towards development of aggregation inhibitors. So this, once there's aggregation, and it shows this fluorescence. So if there's a less aggregation, means there is no fluorescence. So fluorescence, we can directly predict that there is an aggregation takes place due to the fluorescence. And we use epigallantoin as a standard reference, which is a natural product. And you can see from this graph here, compound 5, which is having GlycNAc at this N-terminal end, has shown best aggregation inhibition, which is this compound 5 here. So compound 1 and compound 2. So compound 1 is simple peptide. Compound 2 is with sugar, which has improved, it reduced this aggregation. Glycine residue here, which is compound 6. So addition of this glycine spacer help us to change the face of this peptide, so that if sugar is projected on this side, addition of glycine, sugar will face on this side. So that will just to understand which way it's binding to the alpha-synuclein. We also prepared a peptide using D-amino acid, which is compound 8. It has not shown any additional benefit by adding using D amino acid. And finally, we also compared with peptide in which this sugar was on the C terminal. So for example, in compound 5, sugar we have put on this C terminal, whereas compound 11, the sugar is on C terminal. And you can see that it has not inhibited aggregation. So from this initial preliminary data, we got information that Fog-like oscillation is like depend on position of this sugar residue, and also it's depend on the peptide sequence. So to further confirm our results, we use this dot plot assay. So this assay used conformation specific antibodies or non-conformation specific antibodies, and you can see that compound 5 clearly show that it prevents formation of these alpha-synuclein fibril when we used these assays. So we recently published that work, and then we focused on another protein which is involved in Alzheimer's disease. So all these proteins which are involved in neurodegenerative diseases such as amyloid, beta, tau, alpha-synuclein, they share this mechanism of aggregation. So we thought once we develop any method or probe for testing one protein or peptide, we can use similar method for development of probes for another protein which is involved in aggregation. So based on our initial preliminary results with alpha-synuclein, we wanted to use the same glycopeptide for inhibition of tau aggregation. Tau is involved in Alzheimer's disease. So this is a tau protein, which is a 441 amino acid, which is the predominant isoform. And it involves a couple of repeat domains, N1, N2, and R1 and R4. And it has been suggested that this 400th position of this tau is glycosylated. And just by addition of one sugar residue on this tau, we can see that it inhibits aggregation of tau protein. So this graph is without BLICNAC, and this graph, which is shown in red color, is just addition of GLICNAC at 400 position, and serine at 400 position. So you can see that just addition of one single GLICNAC residue can make a huge difference in aggregation of these 441 amino acid containing protein. So this was reported with whole protein. So we thought, can we use small peptide or glycopeptide instead of using whole protein, like 400 amino acid containing protein? So based on this, we prepared a couple of glycopeptides, which is close from this S400 region. So we wanted to make like peptide with 9 to 10 amino acid, that's maximum. And we use this GLICNAC. And we use these, prepared these 6 peptides for initial preliminary evaluation. And we wanted to check whether these glycopeptides derived from tau protein 400 sequence, close to 400 sequence, can affect aggregation of tau protein. But we faced some challenges because it's very difficult to purify tau protein. So we are like, it's very challenging, and tau protein, it's not commercially available. And still we are working on purifying tau protein. So meanwhile, we thought anyway, we prepared this compound. We will test these compounds for inhibition of aggregation of amyloid beta peptide, because amyloid is also involved in Alzheimer's disease, amyloid beta. And there are reports that tau derived peptides can also involved in prevention of aggregation of amyloid beta. And there is a one theory also that tau initiate aggregation of amyloid beta. So based on that initial like reports, so we thought, can we use this tau derived peptide to prevent aggregation of amyloid beta? So we tested this compound, and we were surprised to see that these compounds, glycopeptides, which is compound 2 here, it can inhibit aggregation of amyloid beta, both at 1:1 as well as 2:2 ratio. So this is confirmed by team images, as well as this Congo red stained images as well. So we can clearly show that this tau derived glycopeptides can inhibit aggregation of amyloid beta peptides. So to summarize our finding, we can say that this O-GLICNAC modification protects misfolding of proteins involved in neurodegenerative diseases. So now change gear and talk about another approach our group is focusing on, understanding aggregation of these proteins in neurodegenerative diseases. So as I mentioned, these neurodegenerative diseases, these are multifactorial diseases. So once they initiate aggregation of amyloid beta, tau, or alpha-synuclein, they also initiate various events, which are such as oxidative stress or activation of inflammatory response. So we need to develop these aggregation inhibitors, which can also target these other processes involved in neurodegenerative diseases, such as oxidative stress or inflammation. So with that hypothesis, we started working on development of like small molecules targeting multiple events in neurodegenerative diseases. So in this project, we prepared a small molecule of pyrazole-furan-fused heterocyclic compounds. So the compound ANLEB, which is a preclinical candidate, this compound, it inhibits aggregation of tau protein, it inhibits aggregation of alpha-synuclein. And that was the starting point for our project. So we thought if we add an additional furan moiety in this ANLEB, and that might further increase activation, inhibition of aggregation of alpha-synuclein and tau. So this was the basic idea, and we wanted to introduce functional ring moieties of ring A and ring B, and that way we can modulate the anti-inflammatory antioxidative response. So we know that this framework is responsible for binding to the alpha-synuclein as well as tau protein. So we wanted to keep the same framework, but with additional effect which can target other events in neurodegenerative diseases. So the idea behind this is that additional furan moiety will provide us additional hydrogen bond interaction with the protein alpha-synuclein backbone, and that way it will improve the aggregation inhibition activity of these compounds. So this is the only chemistry slide in this presentation, a small molecule. And we prepared a library of these chalcones, pyrazolidine, and pyrazole compounds. So the first step involves Suzuki coupling of this bromofuraldehyde. We form this Suzuki coupled product, and then reaction with acetophenone, which gives us this chalcone. So for the reaction of chalcone with hydrazine, give this pyrazoline, and addition of sulfur as oxidant, we got this pyrazole. So we prepared this range of like library of compounds, and we wanted to test these compounds as a aggregation inhibitor for alpha-synuclein and tau protein. We also prepared this pyrazole, pyrazoline, and chalcone based on substitution pattern presenting preclinical candidate ANLEB, which is in preclinical trial. So that's why we give this bromide on this side and this bicyclic compound on this ring A. So wheels like these chalcones, they are reported as a aggregation inhibitors. So based on that, we also wanted to test these chalcones for inhibition of alpha-synuclein aggregation using this thioflavin T fluorescence assay. And you can see that most of the compounds, they have shown very good aggregation inhibition. And the most of active compound is 7K, which has bromine on both sides of these aromatic rings. But we are not further explored due to the liability of this alpha beta unsaturated compound, which is very reactive for Michael addition. So we tested this compound because it was already reported chalcones are aggregation inhibitors, and these are the intermediates in our synthesis. So we screened them. But our main focus was to test the what these pyrazolines, furan pyrazolines, aggregation inhibition activity of these compounds. So you can see that most of the pyrazolines, they have shown aggregation inhibition for alpha synuclein. And the most active compound is compound 8B, which have similar substitution pattern as NLEB compound, and compound 8L, which have exactly same substitution pattern in which this phenyl ring is replaced with the furan moiety. So these are the two most active compounds from the pyrazolin series. We also screened pyrazoles we prepared as a aggregation inhibitors, alpha-synuclein aggregation inhibitors. You can see that the most active compound is compound 9F, and this compound has shown aggregation inhibition activity better than the clinical candidate NLEB-138P. So this compound is much more active than the preclinical candidate. And you can see that this compound can clearly show that this is much more better than the preclinical candidate. So to further understand our outcome of this assay and confirm, we carried out this aggregation inhibition at various ratios, such as 1:1 or 1:5 ratio. And you can see that both these compounds, pyrazoles and pyrazolin, they have shown inhibition, aggregation inhibition, both at 1:1 and as well as 1:5 ratio. To further confirm aggregation inhibition, we carried out this dot plot analysis. So we use this conformation specific antibodies for alpha synuclein, and which confirmed that this pyrazole is active aggregation inhibitor both as 1:1 ratio as well as 1:5 ratio. So to further understand the mechanism of aggregation inhibition and rationalize our results, we carried out molecular modeling, which carried out docking experiment. And for docking, we used human tau protein, because there are reports that these tau as well as alpha synuclein, they both are involved in aggregation, and the aggregation mechanism for both of these compounds is the same. And most of the time, it has been reported that this human tau is responsible for aggregation of alpha synuclein protein. So this tau docking is well established, so we wanted to use which is already reported in the literature. And this slide shows one is A is front view and the B is side view. So this one we used for binding of this standard compound NLE-138B as well as our synthesized compounds. So this shows binding of this pyrazolin to the active site compound 8B. And you can see that this additional oxygen, he has picked up one another hydrogen bond. That's why these compounds, they are very active. So as compared to preclinical candidate, it can form three hydrogen bonds, one extra hydrogen bonds. So that's why these pyrazolines, they are more active. And we also docked pyrazoles and standard preclinical candidate. And the critical hydrogen bond, which is involved in NLE-138B, is hydrogen bond interaction with isoleucine here. So we maintain this hydrogen bond interaction with our pyrazole 9F compound. So to summarize these results, so we have achieved modification of preclinical candidate, and now we got compound much more active than preclinical candidate. So pyrazole and pyrazolines. We further carried out anti-inflammatory activity of these compounds, as well as further role of this compound in inhibiting various oxidative processes. So those results, so we are still not complete. We got initial result. This compound has shown some positive signs. So the main aim of this project is to develop these compounds as a multi-target probe to understand the various processes involved in neurodegenerative diseases. So currently there is no cure for these neurodegenerative diseases, Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease, but there is a hope. And by following this multi-target approach, which will help us to understand various fundamental processes involved in aggregation of these proteins in Alzheimer's diseases, or various multiple events involved in neurodegenerative diseases. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Santosh, for such an informative lecture. Now the session is open for question and answer questions. So is there any question for Dr. Santosh?
I have a quick question. Nice talk, Dr. Santosh, Surajiya. So I have a quick question on your first presentation that, with the Merck compound, they have difluoro group and they're having the good brain uptake. But the compound you are trying to develop, those are the glycosylated compound, might have the limitation of the crossing blood-brain barrier. So did you look at in that angle, or do you have plan to look at in that angle?
Thing is, the Merck compound they are developing as a drug to target these diseases. So our aim is not to develop as a drug. So we are not developing drug targeting these proteins. Our main is to understand the fundamental process of aggregation. So what exactly happens in aggregation, and how these sugar residue helps in prevention of this aggregation. So once we understand this process, and then we can target these small molecules. Definitely, these glycopeptides, they are not as a drug target. They cannot be developed as a drug. And again, it's very difficult to use these as a targeting, especially in brain. So our aim is not to develop as a drugs, but just to understand the mechanism of aggregation.
Yeah, sounds good. I have a second question also on your second presentation. Those pyrazole and the furandrine, I mean, the things is that sometimes, metabolic stability is one of the big concerns with those kind of moiety. When you have the furan and then, the pyrazole and drink, did you look at some, metabolic stability of those compound, or?
We haven't checked metabolic stability, but we checked like cytotoxicity of these compounds. So those compounds, they are not cytotoxic even at 100 micromolar scale. We haven't checked metabolic stability, but definitely these compounds are not cytotoxic.
Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Is there any more questions? It seems there is no more questions. So thank you, Dr. Santosh, for such a nice presentation.
Thank you very much.